American people just now are what you want.
First they were written, proclaimed to the world an idea new among men. They expressed a shining wish for a better way of life. This was the American dream. But that golden goal was not to be had without cost. It was born in adversity, tested by time, perfected and proven only after long experience and trial. This is the drama of a new concept of freedom, of the inspired code of law creating that freedom. The year 1787. In the city of Philadelphia, the Constitutional Convention was in session. After 4 long months of debate and discussion, a new constitution to replace the old and ineffectual Articles of Confederation had finally been written. It was the mutual effort of the best minds in the land, men long experienced in the human art of government. By unanimous consent, George Washington had been chosen president of the convention.
Gentlemen, The warmest friends this Constitution has do not contend that it is free from imperfections. But there is a constitutional door open for change. I think the people can decide on the alterations and amendments which time may prove necessary. Besides, they will have the advantage of experience on their side.
General Washington, sir?
Mr. Franklin.
Fellow delegates, having lived long, I have experienced many instances of being obliged to change opinions which I once thought right. The older I grow, the more apt I am to doubt my own judgment. I cannot help expressing a wish that every member of this convention who may still have objections to it would, with me, doubt a little of his own infallibility, and to make manifest our unanimity, put his name to this instrument.
This was the moment of decision.
New Hampshire, Massachusetts, Connecticut, New York.
When the ceremony was over, 39 delegates had come forward to write their names. Only three withheld their signatures. Thus, on September 17th, 1787, a new constitution to govern the American colonies was signed at Independence Hall. This newly created government was unique. In a world of kings and emperors, would it actually work? The first test was not long in coming. It occurred in George Washington's second term as president, an incident known as the Whiskey Rebellion. In colonial times, corn was an abundant crop but difficult to transport, and for convenience was often converted into distilled spirits. Since this important byproduct was shipped from state to state, the federal government saw fit to levy a tax upon it. But the people objected in principle, and before long their opposition had flared up in riots. Here was the first challenge to the federal authority.
The question remains whether the president has any legal right to use force.
As to the legality of it, Governor Mifflin, I have here an opinion from Justice Wilson advising that the courts of your state are unable to deal with the crisis through ordinary judicial proceedings. Under the law, this would empower me to use the federal militia.
Fortunately, the rebellion ended without bloodshed. The mere size of the militia overawed all further opposition. Washington had shown his people that the government was prepared to ensure domestic tranquility when necessary. Some 40-odd years later, President Andrew Jackson would know the threat of secession.
The federal government's tariff acts are hereby declared null, void, and no law in the state of South Carolina. Could force be used to execute the measures declared void, such efforts will be regarded as inconsistent with the longer continuance of South Carolina in the Union.
Tell them from me that they can talk and write resolutions and print threats to their heart's content. But if one drop of blood be shed there in defiance of the laws of the United States, I will hang the first man of them I can get my hands on to the first tree I can find.
With the people behind him and Congress supporting him, Jackson stood by the Constitution. For the moment, the crisis passed, but it would come again. By 1858, the cause of sectionalism had grown stronger and much more bitter. The burning issues of the day were brought into national focus by a series of debates between the glib and talented Stephen A. Douglas and a self-taught lawyer named Abraham Lincoln.
Right, honest Abe Lincoln! Give it on good, Abe!
Judge Douglas says he doesn't care whether slavery is voted up or voted down.
Neither do we, Lincoln. You know nothing.
Well, friend, I may not know much, but I think I know right from wrong. Now, you say that you don't care whether slavery is voted up or down. Any man can say that who does not see anything wrong in slavery. But no man can logically say it who does see wrong in it. Because no man can logically say he doesn't care whether wrong is voted up or down. I say this government cannot endure permanently half slave and half free. A house divided against itself cannot stand.
That's what you think, you long drink of water.
Yes, my friend. That's what I think. That is the real issue. That is the issue that will continue in this country when these poor tongues of Judge Douglas and myself shall be silent.
As I say, I have known Mr. Lincoln for 25 years. He is a fine lawyer, possesses high ability, and there is no objection to him, except the monstrous revolutionary doctrines which he conscientiously entertains and is determined to carry out if he gets the power.
Don't worry, he ain't gonna get it. Never. No, never, not that hell-fellow rail splitter.
All right, and I tell you that this doctrine of Lincoln's, declaring that men are made equal by the Declaration of Independence and by divine providence, is a monstrous heresy.
My countrymen, if you have been taught doctrines conflicting with those great landmarks of the Declaration of Independence, if you have listened to suggestions which would take away its grandeur, if you are inclined to believe that all men are not created equal in those inalienable rights enumerated by our Charter of Liberty, let me entreat you to come back. Think nothing of me. Take no thought of the political fate of any man whatsoever. But come back to the truths that are in the Declaration of Independence. You may do anything with me you choose, if you will but heed these sacred principles. You may not only defeat me for the Senate, but you may take me out and put me to death. Do not destroy that immortal emblem of humanity. If that declaration is not the truth, let us get the statute book in which we find it and tear it out. Who is so bold to do it?
Come on.
I won't.
Not I.
If it is not true, let us tear it out.
No. No. Never.
Well, let us stick to it then. Let us stand firmly by it.
Abraham Lincoln lost that election of 1858, but in losing, he won. For the people couldn't forget this plain-spoken man from the prairie, and 2 years later they sent him to the White House.
Without union, the Constitution is only a piece of paper. I know there is a God, and that he hates injustice and slavery. I see the storm coming, and I know his hand is in it. If he has a place and work for me, and I think he has, I believe I'm ready. I am nothing, but truth is everything. And with God's help, I shall not fail.
April 12, 1861, Fort Sumter. The cannon spoke for war, civil war, bitter, violent, and devastating.
After four weary and wounding years, the conflict ended. The Union was saved. The Constitution had survived the fiery ordeal. America was one nation, finally and forevermore. In the century to follow, America would know a period of amazing achievement, a time of startling inventions, a time of unbounded creative energy. There seemed no limit to man's far-reaching horizons. It was a time of transition, a time of progress. But the fundamental philosophy of freedom, the belief in the rights of the individual and the dignity of man, remained unaltered. The Constitution was still the rock. Under its guarantees, men were free to speak, free to worship as they pleased, free to enjoy the fruits of their labor, and free to explore new dimensions of their universe.
10, 9, 8, ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4,
there's fire.
3, 2.
Look to the stars, say the wise men. There lies the future. In remote and distant worlds lies the riddle of tomorrow. But where is its answer? If a free world is to endure, then the principles of self-government must be perpetuated. The Constitution is the rock. And the leaders of tomorrow must be as dedicated to its preservation as were the leaders of yesterday, as are the leaders of today. Let us pay homage to the immortal men whose illustrious names have been indelibly inscribed on history's roll of honor. George Washington, John Adams, Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, James Monroe, John Quincy Adams, Andrew Jackson, Martin Van Buren, William Henry Harrison, John Tyler, James K. Polk, Zachary Taylor, Millard Fillmore, Franklin Pierce, James Buchanan, Abraham Lincoln, Andrew Johnson, Ulysses S. Grant, Rutherford B. Hayes, James A. Garfield, Chester A. Arthur, Grover Cleveland, Benjamin Harrison, William McKinley, Theodore Roosevelt, William Howard Taft, Woodrow Wilson, Warren G. Harding, Calvin Coolidge, Herbert Hoover, Franklin D. Roosevelt, Harry S. Truman, Dwight D. Eisenhower, John F. Kennedy, Lyndon B. Johnson, Richard M. Nixon. From these men, the free world may take new inspiration and hope. And if it be wise, new wisdom from old words of prophecy.
This government must be preserved in spite of the acts of any man or set of men. Nowhere in the world is presented a government of so much liberty and equality. To the humblest and poorest among us are held the highest privileges and positions. What constitutes the bulwark of our liberty and independence? It is not the frowning battlements or bristling seacoast, our army and navy,
These are not our reliance against tyranny. Our reliance is in the love of liberty, which God has planted in us. Our defense is in the spirit which prizes liberty as the heritage of all men, in all lands everywhere. Destroy this spirit, and you have planted the seeds of despotism at your own doors. At what point shall we expect the approach of danger? By what means shall we fortify against it? Shall we expect some transatlantic giant to step the ocean and crush us at a blow? Never. All the armies of Europe, Asia, and Africa combined could not by force take a drink from the Ohio or make a track on the Blue Ridge. At what point, then, is the approach of danger to be expected? I answer, if it ever reach us, it must spring up among us. It cannot come from abroad. If destruction be our lot, we ourselves must be its author and its finisher. As a nation of free men, we must live through all time or die by suicide. Surely God would not have created such a being as man with ability to grasp the infinite, to exist only for a day. No. No. Man was made for immortality.
Stands as a symbol of freedom and an inspiration to people all around the world. There is nothing wrong with America that cannot be cured by what is right with America. And there is nothing wrong with the world that cannot be cured by the ideals that America represents. Those principles have no borders. And we look forward to a day when those principles, extended beyond our borders, will have circled the globe. The quest for democracy must continue until all the people of the world enjoy the freedom we must always fight to preserve. The spirit of America is as bright and hopeful today as it was in July of 1776. And we are ready to carry our great national experiment forward into the next millennium.
If the experience of these extraordinary men adds up to any one thing, it is this. To be true to the American dream, one must have the wisdom to remember and the courage to change. In honoring these men, protectors of our heritage, servants of our dream, guides to the future we face together, we honor the enduring meaning of America. We the people, hear in their voices the voice of our own hearts. President Abraham Lincoln.
My fellow countrymen, I have often inquired of myself what great principle or idea it was that kept this Confederacy so long together. It was that all should have an equal chance, that all are created equal. This is the sentiment embodied in the Declaration of Independence. Most governments have been based on the denial of rights. Ours began by affirming our rights. Let us turn this government into the channel in which the framers of the Constitution originally placed it. If we cannot give freedom to every creature, let us do nothing that will impose upon another creature. True democracy makes no inquiry about the color of the skin or place of birth or any other circumstance or condition. We propose to give all a chance. We expect the weak to grow stronger, the ignorant wiser, and all better and happier together. Let it be as nearly reached as we can. For the struggle of today is not altogether for today. It is for the vast future also. So may our children and our children's children for a thousand generations rejoice under those glorious institutions bequeathed us by Washington and continue to enjoy the benefits conferred upon us by a united country.
Bill Clinton and the current President of the United States, George W. Bush.
My fellow Americans, when we look back on the history of this country, we see a record of almost unbelievable energy, sacrifice, hard work, of impossible dreams that our ancestors dreamed and made real. We see injustice, too, that weighs on our hearts even today. But for every injustice, there has always been a voice crying out to right it. And America has always listened to those voices. We are listening today. And perhaps it falls to us, to this first generation of the 21st century Americans, to say once and for all that no child, no race, no creed, no ethnic community will ever again be left out of the American dream. Through education, through the opportunity to work, and to enjoy the fruits of that work, we can open every closed door, expand the horizons of all Americans. Again and again, we return to the same simple principles: freedom, equality, the freedom to create, to prosper, to dream, equality before the law, in the workplace, in the chance for a better life. And each time, in the process, America grows stronger. The beacon of democracy grows brighter. The world looks in new astonishment at what free people can do. We the people are just getting started.
If the experience of these extraordinary men adds up to any one thing, it is this. To be true to the American dream, one must have the wisdom to remember and the courage to change. In honoring these men, protectors of our heritage, servants of our dream, guides to the future we face together, we honor the enduring meaning